Again, everybody. Now, should we try that again? Jon Bon Jovi, so excited about listening to him. A classic all-American band led by this man, sold more than 100 million records worldwide and performed in front of 34 million fans over 30 years at the top of the business. Caught up with their frontman, there he is, in New York. And I started by asking him to tell me how Bon Jovi became one of the most successful touring bands ever.
The Rolling Stones are the bar for everything. I hope someday they'll gracefully retire. For one reason, at least I'll know where the end zone is. You know, as long as they're performing at such a high level in every way, selling tickets and performing as great as they do, they showed me where the end game is. But he's 20 years older than I am and still the best front man in the business, you see. So they are also by far the biggest band in the world. And then, you know, I think that there's others too. We're up there, but we're not there.
How has touring changed from when you first started doing it in the 80s? What are the different challenges for you now?
Well, in truth, I think that I pace it a lot better than we did in the beginning. You know, when you're a kid and you have nothing else to do and nowhere else to go, living out of a suitcase is not only romantic, but it's smart, because you need to go out there and learn to work in front of audiences around the globe, and sure, some that may not even have the commonality of language. In some situations where you were the support act and you had to earn, you know, the attention of that audience. That's how we cut our teeth. And we weren't afraid of doing 240 shows in a tour in a year and then doing it again the next year. I have no desire to do that any longer. So these are much more civil. Both because I don't feel the need or the desire to live out of a suitcase as much.
And when people are trying to, or when bands or you know, solo artists are trying to make their careers now, they tend to go on programs like X Factor and those sort of pros. Is it called the X Factor here in the States?
I can't remember. Well, I know what you're talking about, yeah.
That's a shortcut to fame?
Oh, I think you're asking the question a little broadly. If you're suggesting that a singer who goes on those shows then has a shortcut to fame because of television. Mm. Sure, there's an opportunity. But a great singer is not what necessarily makes a great artist. Case in point, with all due respect, would Mick Jagger have won X Factor? Mm. Bob Dylan have won X Factor? Mm. Bruce Springsteen have won X Factor? Probably not. But they're the greatest artists of rock and roll, right? You could be a great singer and end up working on a cruise ship. What really matters is, do you have the song and are you able to convey that message? So the era has changed, but it really is about the song.
How do you know when you've got a hit song? Do you immediately know?
I've missed the mark many times, and some for the better and some not. I walked out of the room and thought Living on a Prayer was okay. I said, yeah, it's okay. You know, maybe we give it to this soundtrack. That was, and I was laughed at. You know, Richie looked at me and he said, you're crazy. Because it was so new, it was so different, it was such a unique song. It didn't sound like anything on the radio. Same thing with It's My Life or Always, or there have been songs that were so different than what was on the radio that who knew? It's my life. Set the trend. Other times that I thought, this one, you know, is perfect. It's going to be a monster. And it missed the mark.
Now, last time we met, we had afternoon tea together. You won't remember, I haven't washed my hands since. And you spoke so fondly of your wife, who you were college sweethearts. Tell our viewers.
High school is so we refer to it in America, yeah. High school. Hallelujah, amen. You know, I got it right the first time.
What attracted you to her?
Everything, mostly her independence, her kind of confidence that shined even beyond her beauty. I love an independent, strong, thoughtful woman. And my goodness, I guess it's almost 40 years now we've been together. almost. So, but that was it. Yeah, she's a very strong, smart, independent woman.
How does she feel about you going on tour? Does she she goes with you?
No, rarely. You know, the thing is that fortunately she was here before there was a book to write. You know, she was there for every page in the book before there was a book, and through the ups and the downs and the rewards and the prices I've had to pay for it, we paid them together. So you know, the rest of it is what it is.
Do you get involved with charity work? Tell me about that.
Our foundation is a big part of what we do.
But you're hands-on?
Very.
Yeah.
So we started the foundation in 2003 under the guise of sports ownership, but we were all things to all people. I was being Robin Hood. If you needed a dollar and we had it, we gave it to you. One day the focus came to me when I realized there was a homeless man sleeping on the street, and I thought, I don't need a scientist to find the cure. All you needed was some sweat equity and desire. So we
sweat equity, I love that.
Yeah, well, I had to really get down and dirty and figure out what we could do to truly make a difference. Mm-hmm. So a dear friend of mine who was born and bred in Philadelphia found me what I realize now is one of the experts nationwide in the field, and she's a nun by the name of Sister Mary Scullion. When I first met her, she thought maybe we could afford enough money to build one row home. And I said, what would it take to do the block? She says, I like your thinking, you know, and we became fast friends. She taught us everything we knew, and the reason I thought about the block was because I thought if we could fix a block, we could fix a neighborhood. If we could fix a neighborhood, maybe we could affect the city. So we thought big. We did the block. We've gone on to build hundreds of homes together. But when the economic downturn happened, not well, worldwide, but starting here in America, Dorothea's focus was on feeding the same people that we housed. And she created the model of the Soul Kitchen, which quickly is there aren't any prices on our menu. If you can come and you want to affect change directly, there's a suggested donation you can leave. But no obligation. Should you want to volunteer for your meal, you do. And that helps us with the shortfall. And that gives a great sense of pride to those who are both in need and want to serve their community. So you'll never know who's in need and who's not. But truthfully, if you came and just wanted to participate with a donation, you'd almost feel like you're missing out on the party because you want to participate in some way. So you'll be bussing a table or working in the garden or washing a dish. And that's what makes it work. And in turn, we have fed, you know, nearly 90,000 people in 6.5, 7 years.
You were saying just before we started filming about the fact that the UN General Assembly is just down the road, which is why the traffic is so bad at the moment. When these politicians get together, do you think they actually achieve? Are they a force for good?
Look, you got to anyone who finds political purpose and does something for good. Do I think that there are those who are self-serving? Yeah. Do I think that they should shake it up? Yeah. Do I think we should listen to each other a lot more? Yeah. You know, so I have issues with politics by and large. But those who get in it to serve have all, you know, my respect.
We're running a campaign, actually, at Sky Television at the moment because we don't do what you do here. in the US. We do have debates with our political leaders ahead of a general election, but it's not enshrined in law, so we don't see our political leaders necessarily on TV speaking live
debating.
To each other. Yeah, oh, taking each other on. Do you think, what's your view on that? We've been asking a lot of people that we've been chatting
to. I think healthy debate is fantastic. I was glued through the primaries, let alone in the general election, watching candidates from both sides. Because to be honest, I was listening with open ears to both sides. And I have nothing against the Republican viewpoint, as long as it's somebody that I feel will talk across the aisle. So I truly did listen. And I was engaged throughout the process. And the voice of the people has spoken here because our electoral college is what it is. And so we have to live with that. But I find healthy debate to be great, and it should be something that people really engage in. Yeah.
Who do you think your fan base is these days?
I think it's wide. Not only is it generational, but I think it's purple. You know, in America, we call them the reds and the blue
sure.
states, right? But I think that we're fortunate enough to cross openly and, you know, and honestly in debate and engagement. Like I said, I honestly have no issues with a Republican agenda. I think that, you know, truthfully, I'm probably socially, you know, one way and fiscally another. But that shouldn't hinder the opinions of those to the far right or the far left.
We call them champagne socialists in the United Kingdom.
Is that what you call them?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, I'm very liberal with social standpoints and somewhat more conservative when it comes to fiscal stuff. So, you know, I'm open.
Have you ever thought about running for office?
No, thank you.
Why not?
First and foremost, I don't have the education for it. Secondly,
nonsense.
The truth of the matter is that I think that you become well-versed in a couple of issues. You have a lesser knowledge, but you can BS your way through a couple of more, and then you really have no knowledge of several others that your assistants are handing you and making you read postcards. I don't have any desire to be involved in that. So I know what we do, feeding people and building shelter, and like I said, it doesn't need a scientist to find the cure. All it takes is money and sweat. So we're able to do that, and we do it.
But by using your celebrity, you can shout louder. I'm thinking particularly of people like Cynthia Nixon. She's chosen to obviously she was Sex in the City. Now she's trying to run for New York governor,
I think. She tried to.
Yeah, sadly it didn't work out for her this time. So you can use your celebrity in lots of different ways, can't you?
Celebrity is not a soapbox to any bigger, broader issue. Should it move you in your life? When you close your eyes at night, then I applaud anyone and everyone to find a soapbox to get up on. But those who may use their celebrity without a desire or knowledge of the subject that they're getting involved in, it's just a photo op, and that's yucky to me.
Mm. Have you thought about being a UN ambassador?
I have enough hard time trying to sing at night.
America's viewed in the world these days?
Good question. Yeah, I'm not going to throw stones. I think that I've worn my politics on my sleeve. Everybody that knows who I voted for and why. There was an article I did in The Statesman that I guess has come true where I said the world's going to be a much different place if it goes this way. I think the world's a much different place. I hope that it just makes all of us realize that, you know, working together on this little marble in the middle of a spinning something is better than putting up walls and fences. And, you know, we're all, at the end of the day, much more alike than we are different, regardless of where you come from, the color of your skin, or even your political beliefs. You know, I just count in on the future. Because the present is very tumultuous.
My administration has accomplished more than almost any administration in the history of our country. America's so true. Didn't expect that reaction, but that's okay.
Just to mention Melinda Gates in passing, and then I want to ask you about the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I asked her about how America was viewed in the world these days and how the UN General Assembly had openly laughed at the president.
Yeah.
And how she felt about that.
How did she feel about it?
Well, she paused for about 15 seconds. She gave it a great deal of thought. And then she... Well, what do you think? And I'll tell you what she said.
I think I told you what I think. So, you know, I think I told you succinctly what I think. So what did she say?
She basically said that she was, what you said, she was sad about the situation that the country had found itself in for now, but she was hopeful for the future. And you endorse that message?
I feel the same. You know, I'm greatly disappointed in where we are. As are many people around the world.
Talk to me about Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You joined it last year? Why did it take so long?
Well, like politics, there's internal
politics.
And for whatever reason, you know, it took to when it took. And on the other hand, I honestly can tell you that the time that it took beyond our first ballot induction period, made it ultimately the sweeter. I think that I'm enjoying it more now than I may have 9 years ago when we were first eligible.
And if somebody was to ask you, what's your favorite song, not yours, but songs that you listen to on the radio, I always say Otis Redding, Sitting on the Dock of the Bay.
Well, Otis great would be song. Right up there. Mm. How about Sam Cooke, Change Is Gonna Come?
Oh, yeah.
You know, the first thing that came to my mind, I sure wish I'd written that. Bridge Over Troubled Water, mm-hmm. Dylan's Times They Were Changing. You know, there's a plethora of songs that move me. That's the greatest compliment I pay, is I say, I wish I wrote that.
Final thought. What would you say to young people who are thinking about going into your industry?
God bless you. Do it. You know, it's. I think that music has had its ebbs and flows, but with the advent of the internet, I think that we're back up onto a wave. In as much as my earlier example, Bob Dylan can be discovered again, because he's not going to get on the radio. BBC One's never going to play the new Bob Dylan record, but via the internet, that voice and those words can be heard. And so, you know, I look at it as an opportunity for artists to create a new paradigm, you know, and not to have to follow a contest on a television show or coming up as a, you know, raucous rock band like the, you know, we pretended to be and the Stones wanted to be, you know. So you can be something unique to yourself these days.
Question you're all left asking, though, is he going to go back on tour? Wait and see. I'll tell you next month. In the last...